Hey, hello, it's me, Anna Maria Michalciano, Java developer advocate at Oracle, and it's a time for you to learn about the JDK tools enhancements after Java 17. We will jump into action with the Java C compiler power-up and having javadoc as sidekick. Next, we'll take a look at jshell and how this tool helps us steer our code experiments, like Mario navigating threshold levels. We will bounce up through the Java kingdom with jwebserver, serving web pages like a seasoned plumber, then pack your applications with jpackage into neat little boxes like warp pipes. We'll collect module files like coins with jmod to promote better encapsulation and reusability of code. With the keytool and jarsigner duo, you'll unlock secure secrets and sign your code with the royal stamp. Lastly, we'll explore the hidden levels of performance with JFR and unleash your superpower of optimizing code with JMC. So let's strap our virtual overalls and prepare to power up with the whole arsenal of tools. JDK 21 comes with a new JFR view command,
introduced a new add snippet tag,
and our jwebserver, a minimal HTTP static file server. In Java world, the mighty Java C compiler reigns supreme. In JDK 18, the core check of Java C serial link warning was improved, verifying the presence of a properly declared serial version UID field in serializable classes that use write-object, read-object, write-replace, read-resolve, and many more. For example, you can serialize and deserialize a record class with custom serialization logic using write-replace and read-resolve. When serializing, let's say you perform some extra computation with a long and a double variable. Normally, when a computation with a long and a double variable is performed, Java C produces an incompatible types error. But when the same computation is done with a plus equals operator, or also with similar operators like minus equals, then this error does not occur. As of JDK 20, running Java C with option all to enable all the warnings flags such situations with a warning about typecasts in compound assignments with possible lossy conversions. The Java compiler gets better and better with each JDK release, and some of those changes are hidden to mere developer eye, but you feel them in your code. As Java C soars to new heights, enhancing its code crunching capabilities, javadoc, like a wise toad, reveals a few great changes between Java 17 and 21 as well. Let's take a look, Java developers! Just like Mario collects power-up mushrooms, having code snippets and API documentation gives it a brilliant shine, like a gleaming gold coin. And your colleagues will definitely appreciate those too. Let's hear about that from the expert, Jonathan Gibbons. Hey Jonathan, can you tell us a bit about how code snippets can be embedded in our code?
Prior to JDK 18, you could include formatted multiple line fragments of source code in documentation using an HTML pre tag and at code. A pre is the default HTML tag for pre-formatted text, meaning that HTML renderers know by default that the code within the tag should be displayed literally. And a code snippet embedded within at code displays the special characters correctly, so they don't need to be manually escaped. JEP 4.13 introduced a new at snippet tag to simplify the inclusion of example source code in API documentation. Moreover, the snippet tag provides better control of indentation compared to no control at all with the preceding pre and at code tags. This new at snippet tag enables a better presentation of the targeted code examples via regions, which are optionally named ranges of lines that identify the text to be displayed by a snippet. You can mark the beginning of a region by either putting at start region equals name, the region name, or an highlight, replace, or link tag that specifies the region name, or explicitly region equals the region name. You can omit the region name if it's not needed by the matching end tag. The snippet tag accepts a few attributes that are expressed in simple key value pairs. And moreover, the tag accepts separate files that contain the content of the snippet. Keeping snippets in external files makes it easier for tools to find and validate their content, like, let's say, compiling Java source code to be shown in a snippet. The most important thing to configure is where to find the file, which you can do with specifying the file attribute file equals and the file name. External files can be placed either in a snippet file subdirectory of the package containing the snippet tag or in a completely separate directory of your choice. If you choose the latter, you should use the dash dash snippet path option with the path to the source tree that you put the demo files into. And that's it.
Thank you. Mamma mia, that looks cool. For more examples on how to use code snippets, you can watch Inside Java Newscast number 20. You know what would make javadoc even cooler? Making your documentation even more interactive. How? Easy. Configuring the --addscript file option of javadoc. When using --addscript file, the specified file will be copied to the generated documentation, and a script element is added to every generated HTML page, except the pages that serve only to redirect to other pages. You can use this option to specify multiple scripts to be included in the generated documentation. If you're worried about potential unreported errors when linking external documentation to yours, you can try --link modularity mismatch option of the javadoc. In case you're linking to non-modular documentation for a modular library, you will get either a warning or an informational message. Speaking of finding information, javadoc navigation has improved on small devices. Now it is even easier to search within documentation on your mobile or tablet and share that URL, including its query string, with your colleagues. Additionally, that improved Preview API page provides a detailed list of the Preview API elements in a release. This page lists the name of the Preview APIs in the release, such as Foreign Function and Memory API, and Virtual Threads, before showing the complete list of elements. Moreover, in this page, the preview language features and the preview VM features in the release are linked to their respective JDK enhancement proposals. We had enough fun with javac and javadoc, so I think it's time to level up our knowledge with what's new in development and deployment JDK tools. Here we go! Let's see what's going to happen next! The JDK comes with several tools to help you streamline development, deployment, and maintenance of Java applications. While these tools serve different purposes, they collectively contribute to a great overall development experience because they facilitate interactive coding, application packaging, web server development, and managing jar files. I'll start with my favorite tool to quickly run Java code snippets, jshell. Starting with JDK 9, you can use jshell to experiment with different Java language features. Moreover, as of JDK 19, jshell highlights deprecated elements, variables, and keywords. So be careful. When you pinch deprecated elements, they pinch back. In the wacky world of web development, you sometimes just need a minimal web server that serves static files only. No CGI or server-like functionality, nada. Enter jwebserver, a minimal HTTP static file server that can help you with web development testing when you need a local testing server to simulate a client-server setup. Web service or application testing, where you use static files as API stubs in a directory structure to mirror RESTful URLs and contain dummy data. Informal browsing and sharing of files across systems too, like searching a directory on a remote server from your local machine. And is great for educational purposes as it requires a minimal setup. Just install JDK 18 and have fun with it. While the command line tool is very useful, you can use the simple web server, meaning the server, handler, and filter, with existing code via its API. All in all, use jwebserver whenever you need fast prototyping, ad hoc coding, or testing your API. When distributing software, one common way to deliver it to the end user is via an installable package. This package is compatible with the user's native platform, for example, DMG files on macOS and MSI files on Windows. Jpackage is the command line tool that helps you create native installers and packages for Java application. When Jpackage creates a deployment image, that image contains an embedded configuration file. Until JDK 19, installation of a Jpackaged application was a system-wide one, because startup parameters were stored in the system-wide installation location. But folks in the Java community reported that there are use cases when user-specific startup parameters need to be specified. So, as of JDK 19, application launcher of the installed application will look up the corresponding .cfg file in the user-specific directories. If the .cfg file is not found, the application launcher will load the .cfg file from the installation directory. Application launcher executed from application image, meaning not from the installed application, will load the corresponding .cfg file from the application image directory. And speaking about packaging applications, let's see what presents jmod brings. The main purpose of jmod is to create module files having the jmod extension that encapsulate a set of compiled Java classes, resources, and other related files. You can distribute these module files later on to be consumed by other modules or applications. In order to specify a compression level while creating the jmod archive, you can use the --- compress command line option. This option accepts values between zip 0 to 9, where zip 0 provides no compression and zip 9 provides the best compression. The default compression value is zip 6. With the jmod image, you can further create a custom JRE with the required modules and a custom application launcher for your application. You can find out more about other JDK tools changes that can impact your code migration from a JDK version to 21 by watching Nikolai's video on upgrade hurdles to Java 21. This was a long section, but I'm all recharged with knowledge and I'm ready to roll into the JDK security tools updates. In the Java kingdom, every digital secret needs protection, but how can you know which encryption algorithms are weak and which are strong? Luckily, keytool shows a warning when using disabled key certificate algorithms. For example, you get a warning if you're using algorithms configured on JDK TLS disabled algorithms or JDK certpath disabled algorithms inside Java security file. You also get a warning if you're using a weak key certificate algorithm configured on JDK security legacy algorithms. As of JDK 21, the keytool genset key and import pass commands have been updated to warn users when weak password-based encryption algorithms are used when creating or importing a secret key. This enhancement takes into account the value you specify in the key alg option and issues a warning in case you attempt to use a weak algorithm. Besides useful warning, keytool uses larger default key sizes in janky pair if key size option is not specified. For jarsigner, if a disabled key algorithm is used in a signed jar file, jarsigner will show a warning and the JDK will treat the file as unsigned. Similarly, jarsigner will show you a warning if you try to sign a jar with a weak key certificate algorithm from JDK security legacy algorithms. Also, JDK 18 SHA-1 jars are disabled by default, and the jarsigner tool has been enhanced to more accurately detect and warn you if your jar is affected by this change. Attention! Even though SHA-1 jars are disabled by default, those timestamps prior to 1st of January 2019 are not restricted yet. By default, jarsigner performs certificate chain validation when signing or verifying jar files, but it doesn't check for certificate revocation. Users won't be able to know if the certificates are revoked and should no longer be trusted. The --ref check option will direct jarsigner to check the revocation status of the certificates. As of JDK 19, if you need to specify the class path of an alternate key store implementation, you can now add it via the provider path option. Additionally, the default signature and digest algorithms used when signing jar files with jarsigner have been strengthened. This change is reflected in the supported algorithm section of the jarsigner specification. You can find out more about modern cryptographic algorithms and weak legacy ones by watching the Java Security Road to 21 video. Oh boy. Finally, I'm getting a move on monitoring tools enhancements. JDK Flight Recorder and JDK Mission Control are dynamic duo tools that provide powerful insights into the performance and behavior of Java applications. JDK 21 comes with a new JFR view command that displays aggregated event data in the shell. To use the command on a running JVM, first start a JFR recording via the -XS start flight recording or JCMD. Once the application is running, you can use the GPS tool to list all running Java processes. Use the PID or the name of the jar class filename together with the JFR view and the name of the view to display, like the methods that execute the most. If you like to limit the data seen in a view to a custom time range, use the parameters maxAge and maxSize. What excites me most about this new command? You can use it to view information about an application without the need to dump a recording file or open up JDK Mission Control. If you like to learn more about this new command and other JFR enhancements, check out Billy's Inside Java Newscast number 53. Speaking of the JDK Mission Control, there are a few exciting enhancements there too. Firstly, as a Mac user, I was delighted to find out that starting with version 8.2.1, JDK Mission Control is available for Apple M1 machines. I use the Apple ARM bundle to install JMC on my laptop and work like a charm. Next, JDK Mission Control offers stack trace graphs as part of its comprehensive toolset for performance analysis and monitoring. Stack trace graphs used such as graph, flame, heat map, and dependency are currently supported on Linux and Mac. Rendering large graphs is also possible with smart pruning. You can focus on the most impactful nodes, and in the Max Nodes dropdown, select the target number of nodes, and the visualization will render maximum of that many nodes. Furthermore, you can aggregate the flame graph and stack trace by selecting the required attribute, and in the Samples dropdown, you can select either allocation size, sample weight, or TLAP size. The flame view or stack trace view is presented according to the sample selected. The dependency view presents aggregation of events using hierarchical edge bundling. For example, it helps in visualizing the dependencies between packages. The chord diagram shows packages arranged radially around a circle with arcs connecting the data points to indicate dependencies. By examining the stack trace graphs, you can understand the interactions between different methods and identify patterns that may indicate inefficiencies or areas of improvement. JMC stack trace graphs empower you to pinpoint performance issues, optimize your code, and make data-driven decisions to enhance the performance and responsiveness of your Java applications. And that's all about significant updates on JDK Tools Road to JDK 21. I hope that this video will assist you to swiftly navigate through the complexities of your application's execution flow. If you enjoyed watching it, please do me a favor and hit that like button. Also, subscribe, click the bell, and leave your feedback or questions in the comment section. Okie dokie, bye bye!